complete liberation, and he makes arguments about how we should achieve complete liberation. So people have been thinking about this, they have been writing about this. And of course, this point I make that we need to revisit communalism as a viable economic, socio-economic paradigm for Africa's development. And I argue this, particularly looking at Walter Rodney, Samir Amin, Daniel Brazales, and many others, who actually have written books making a case that the pre-colonial Africa, or pre-main capitalist, as Samir Amin calls, the period before the arrival of colonialism, that this economy, the African economy, before the arrival of colonists, actually functioned very well and was able to serve the people. And therefore, I'm arguing that we need to go back to better understand that economy, how it functioned, because people have written about it. And I would imagine, for instance, if you go back to one letter in Timbuktu, those manuscripts may guide us. And communalism is not limited to capacity for accumulation through productivity, but it's also about, I argue, or from what I'm reading in history, it's about a shared common interest, it's about collectivism and neighborliness. The definition, of course, that I like about this this concept, this philosophy or approach of colonialism is Walter Rodney in his book, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, first published in 1973. He explains communalism as a system where property is collectively owned, work is done in common, and goods are shared widely. Of course, this is very contrary to what colonialists and capitalists would think. For instance, if you look at the history of Southern Africa, or the most southern tip of our continent, the farming before the arrival of colonialists, or before the arrival of Portuguese at first, and then Dutch, and then later on the English, we know that the land, the way it was used, it belonged to the whole of the community. It was for agricultural production for the whole of the community. But of course, colonists misunderstood this because of very kindness, according to history books, of Africans. We welcomed colonists to share this land, but then they appropriated it, and it caused a lot of problems. What a lot of this is written about, King Mushasha, for instance, all attempts to the British monarchy, requesting them to please intervene because this is not what he expected. He was just giving colonists an opportunity to share and also produce and also feed themselves, but not to appropriate the land that belongs to the community. Communalism as a philosophy, I also argue that it seems to me that it resonates with the principles of Ubuntu or Ujamaa or Harambe and many similar humane principles which epitomize the cultural identity of the various peoples of Africa. So if you think about all of us in the continent, there's that sense of community, I argue, and that our concern is about the welfare of everyone and not just individuals or for our own. Let me try and conclude. So we need to better understand, I argue, the pre-colonial African economy. This is an area I'm trying to write in. And I think if we better understand it, we may be able to distill better lessons for the current African economy and going forward. And that it's about time that Africa discards concepts and theories that are not applicable to our context. It's not just the theories and concepts. It seems to me that it's also inaccurate or inappropriate analysis of the African condition, that therefore there's no recommendations about how to address the problem, and actually because the analysis itself is wrong. This is the case that Tandi Kamkhandawiri, Charles Soludu, many others at the bio, at the stage, many others who argue that actually the state adjustment programs which were imposed by the World Bank and IMF and their sponsors completely misunderstood the African economy, and they caused even more harm to the African economy. So a social economic model that is based on communalism, I argue, should facilitate the integration of the African continent into a single geopolitical entity. And that we need to undo the damage that was done by the Berlin Conference in 1885. I keep arguing in the written lecture that we need to go back, way back, to better understand our history. It seems to me this is one of the issues that we need to pay more attention to, because these artificial boundaries that the Berlin Conference drawn actually are causing more problems, more harm for the continent in terms of, you know, deprivation, intermittent wars, and many other problems. And I use a case of the Sahel region, sub-region, where we have endless conflict and problems. And I agree that because of these artificial boundaries that move people to where they believe they don't belong, and they think they belong somewhere else, or they could function better if they were somewhere. So we need to revisit this. I think it's important for the continent to go back, way back, and unpack this, and of course come up with better proposals. So to have a better world, a better Africa, because it's not just our continent that is in trouble, the whole world, we know, is in trouble. We do need thought leadership and thought liberation, and most importantly also critical consciousness. These, I argue, are important and necessary ingredients to take our continent forward. And I've argued, and many have argued this point, that the fundamental African challenge has to do with the historical experience of colonialism and this skewed global social, political, and economic order. And if we don't address this, we will keep, you know, blaming somebody else. Of course, there are people that should take blame. But the essence is that we're dealing with a very profound historical experience that we need to undo. And of course, we're dealing with global power relations that need to change. And I've proposed that if you think about the African economy, there are specific areas that we need to be paying more attention to. So I've highlighted, for instance, social policies, and I've written a bit on this, and a couple of publications that try and expand on this idea. Because I've argued that many of the countries in our continent do not have effective social policies. I know this are for graphs, and I'm not sure I see Professor Chimatesena here, because I think he disagrees with this perspective. But I highlight only two or three countries in the continent that I think we could argue have an effective social policy. The rest of them don't have. They've got different elements of social protection. So I have that social policy is very important. Entrepreneurship, I think, is very important because most of us study in order to be employed, but you could also do something else. And I think when I talk about entrepreneurship here, I'm talking about a different kind of an entrepreneur than the entrepreneurs that we see, which are just concerned about maximizing their profit. And I think state ownership is extremely important. Of course, the devil is in the detail about how you structure or how you design that state ownership, but it's very important that states in our continent have control on the means of production. And lastly, that intra-Africa trade is very important. We recently wrote a paper with one of our postdoc fellows here at Timani about this, and the argument we make is that Africa needs to be thinking about countries that we call anchor countries that can pull the African economy forward. And in fact, we've named Kenya, South Africa, Nigeria, and a few others. That if those countries could get their act together, and then, of course, the precondition of all of this is unity, African unity, the continent could move forward. We could trade within the continent and do more. Samir Amin had a much more radical view on this. He argued in 1980 that basically Africa needs to de-link from the rest of the world. I said a bit more about this in the lecture. His argument was that Africa integrated incorrectly to the global economy through slave trade at first, and later on through colonialism. And he argued in that piece that if Africa could de-link, disengage, get its house in order, then re-engage with the global world in its own terms, it could be different. Of course, he argues that during that period, South Africa must then vigorously pursue socialism, which I disagree with, because I think these Marxist concepts don't actually apply in the African continent. I have been trying to expand on that idea. Hence, I argue for communalism. So we must be mindful that, however, we may be just scratching the surface. Many economists, leading African economists, Tandi Amukandaweri, Adebayo Adeteji, and many others, and a number of us believe or share their view that the key to the development, to the advancement of the African economy would be to restructure the African economy. You need to restructure it understandably because it was not designed to function effectively. It was basically designed to serve the core economy, the so-called core economies. Because Africa was understood as peripheral economy or satellite economy to serve the economy. And that, therefore, you need to change that structure. However, I argue you won't really achieve much. What you need, as I argue in the written lecture, is that you need a new vision for the African economy. So, for instance, when I talk about unemployment, and people agree with this, that unemployment is largely a labor market challenge. It's because of the constraints in the labor market. But that very same labor market, I argue, is constrained by the structure of the economy itself. And therefore, if you're just trying to change the structure of the economy, you might not achieve much. Rather, what you need to be thinking, redesigning an economy, thinking of an economy that can work for the people than the people that work for an economy. So for instance, in many countries here in Southern Africa in particular, many economists get this wrong, I argue, that unemployment is a skills constraint, is a challenge of skills. And I argue this cannot be right, because first of all, these economies are not growing fast enough. Then because you couldn't hit a binding constraint on skills if your economy is only growing at about 4 or 5%, which is the case for most of our economies, even though actually for Southern Africa. And in a sense, what I'm pursuing is it not possible to think of an economy that can make use of the skills that you have, that then, you know, to keep worrying about the mismatch on skills, because this is an issue in economics, that the economy needs a lot of skills, but the skills were supplied, so it's a supply issue. That is a supply side issue, that the skills were supplied and not the correct ones for the economy. Of course, I've argued elsewhere in my other publications that in the case of South Africa, actually, unemployment is not a supply side issue, it's a demand side issue. It has to do with the behavior of firms. Firms are basically discriminating on certain grounds, and I go into a bit of detail about that. And so far, in conclusion, Principal Vice Chancellor, is that some of us have been thinking about a possibility, or we've reached a tentative view that the African continent might have missed the 21st century, and that rather we should be thinking about putting in place the foundation so that the African continent can be the continent. In other words, or put differently, the 22nd century can be the century for the African continent, because we've missed these ones. We argue that the Asian subcontinent has taken over or is far ahead of the African continent. If you look at, for instance, levels of human development, levels of economic growth themselves, and many other variables, you could reach this conclusion. And by the way, the 21st century is almost over. It's just about 8 years, and time flies. It's almost over. And to make sure that Africa captures the 22nd century, we need three ingredients, or there must be three pillars. Mm-hmm. And this one is that knowledge production institutions have to be effective and have to be strong, that the citizenry has to be practically engaged, particularly with the policy process. And instances where there's no policy process, we must decision must create the policy process. In other words, basically arguing for agency from the side of Africans, and thus the regional integration we should believe will take the continent forward. The, in a sense, precondition for all of this is of course African unity, and we know that we've got a lot of challenges about unity. Again, in conclusion, I have this list that, you know, I think as Africans need to work harder to liberate ourselves from the various destructive thought patterns. We like parties, big parties, and this, by the way, is across cultures, and some of us think that this is a problem. The penchant of seeking paid employment at the expense of seeking to create jobs. This destructive thought pattern needs to change, and we need to unlearn, of course, a number of these which were fed to us by colonialists. The lack of willing to accept correction or criticism. Many people don't like to be criticized or to be told you could do it better, although they do sometimes say they only need constructive criticism. There's a problem of pride of position, and this perhaps is actually the case with our leaders, and this alienates others, and it's a problem. There's a problem of lack of team spirit, there's unnecessary envy and jealousy, and there seems to be a preference for everything that's foreign. If you look at the dress, culture, language, aesthetics. And by the way, we forget that most of this originates here in the African continent. So we need to be revisiting history of aesthetics before the arrival of colonists, the music, which actually most colonists learned, according to history, from Africans. And of course, wrote it as their invention or discoveries from Europe.